topic which we, you know, frequently come across, and it's a very common part of our lives. So, professional ethics. So, every profession has some certain set rules and regulations, or a expected set of behavior, which is called as code of conduct. So, according to profession, this code of conduct varies. That is the set of rules and regulations, which basically means ethics will vary. So, when we talk about dentistry, so in dentistry, there are various aspects. There is one aspect wherein we are dealing with money. We are giving a service to a patient, and in return, we are getting paid for it. That is private fee-for-service type of payment method. Then there are sometimes we are seeking dental education or giving dental education. For example, an institute where to seek dental education, we are paying some fee, and in return, the institute is providing us dental education, which again is dealing with the monetary terms. That means business. Then there are a lot of aspects and prospects where we are actually dealing with research. So all those sets of rules and regulations or code of conduct that we are supposed to follow while we are conducting a research is called as research ethics. At the same time, we are also practicing in dental clinics as a dental practitioner. And there we have certain expectations to fulfill towards our colleagues as well as towards our patients and vice versa. So this part of our profession will be dealt as ethics as dental practitioner. So to I have primarily come up with three dimensions that we, you know, frequently come across in our profession. There are various other dimensions also. I have chosen these three dimensions because these are commonly observed patterns. So in brief, we'll be seeing about it. So business ethics. What are the rules and regulations for business ethics? You can see various things here. Then there are 12 principles. The business part of our profession should actually obey or try to include these principles amongst it. The first being honesty. That is, be honest in all the communications and actions. You as a student, if you have committed any mistake, you are supposed to be honest. Go and tell to the professor, sir, mistakenly I did so and so thing, and now patient is showing this sign. Be honest about it. First thing, be honest towards your patient that we did this treatment, but this particular implant has failed. Be honest about it. If that treatment is not going to be very successful, don't give him hopes. Okay. And right presentation of facts. Under presentation, mispresentation, or over presentation. None of it is good. Be honest. Just communicate it. This is the way it happened. And then we have integrity. Integrity is, if you can see the last line of this slide, basically consistency between thoughts, words, and actions. You are giving LA to a patient and you're saying, oh, this needle won't hurt a lot. It's actually a lie. And you're not supposed to say that. You see, you're supposed to say it will hurt a little. You're supposed to give him a foresight about it so that he prepares his brain accordingly. You know, so if you say no, it won't pain, but it is actually paining to the patient. So thoughts, words, and actions are not meeting. Thoughts, words, and actions. Or maybe let's just say you commit to a patient that 15 tarikh ko so and so denture aa jayega, and 15 tarikh ko wo nahi aa raha. Then you gave 20 tarikh. Then again, this tarikh pe tarikh date wala session is going on. So there is no consistency between thoughts, words, and actions. For example, a student says, yeah, I'll do everything, but they will not do any assignment. They will not be present in the lecture. So there is no consistency between thoughts, words, and actions. So integrity is basically maintaining, you know, enough amount of trust amongst your colleagues. Then promise keeping and trustworthiness. As I just gave an example, promise keeping and trustworthiness. If you said that by 15th, this job will be done, then it should be done. Then when these promises are kept, then only the other person of the party will actually start developing trust towards you. That is, trustworthiness will develop, which is a very important aspect of business. And then we have loyalty. So if we are working for an organization, or if we are working under a senior dentist, or maybe as a student, we have to be loyal towards it by various ways, by doing your best, by doing various things, but at the same time maintaining loyalty. Then we have another principle, which is fairness. Fair is like treating everyone equal. Nobody gets so much of power in hand. No employee gets so much of power in your hand that they misuse it and take undue advantage of it. At the same time, whatever is dealt, strive to be fair and just in all the dealings. Make it a point that nobody is harmed in the entire process. And then caring and concern for others. Okay, we are working 30 days a week and every day patients are coming to our clinic. But there is a possibility that maybe your assistant won't be able to make that day. Or maybe the patient calls on the end moment and says, so and so is the problem and I won't be able to be there. So one has to be very compassionate towards other people. We have to show concern towards them, and then only the team goes strong. Whatever it is, everybody has rights, autonomy, privacy, and everybody has different likings and interests in lives. So whatever they like, they can do it. Not necessarily that every other person in an organization or a dental clinic will be same. No, they might have different approach towards life. So that's their personal approach towards life. It should not be mixed with their professional views. So in that way, when you are not intriguing into their personal lives, you are trying to give them respect. Or maybe it's an opinion from two different branches, an opinion by a prosthodontist and an opinion by an endodontist. So respect everyone. Maybe both the opinions might be different, but probably they are own making a sense from their own point of view. So other employees, two people, two students, two teachers, or a senior or a junior should have respect for each other. And then law abiding. Amidst all the dental practice and all the money that we are making, we have to obey the law. If the law says there is no crowding allowed, then we actually can't go and conduct a camp and calling people there to collect together conspicuously. So whatever it is, whatever you do in the profession, you have to be law-abiding. That is a very important ethical principle that we all must have. And then commitment to excellence. Commitment to excellence, there is a beautiful picture that I have added here, that productivity is never an accident. It is always the result of a commitment to excellence. Intelligent planning and focused effort. So if every person in the institute or the dental clinic or the class decides that they will never read an answer incompletely, they will read it completely, they will never write an answer incompletely, they will make it a point that they'll complete that particular answer, they will never leave a doubt unleft in their mind. So when we strive for excellence in everything that you do, that's a very important business ethic that every employee of the institute or a dental clinic must have. And then leadership. Leadership, because if the subordinates of the dental clinic or the institute are being imposed with a certain set of rules that they're supposed to follow, but if the leaders of the institute don't follow those set of rules, then they are probably not leading by example. So to bring the basic change in the ethical application of all these principles, the leader should lead by example. And then we have reputation and morale. So reputation is usually of the institute or of the dental clinic, and morale is usually of the people who are working for it. So it is interdependent. If the reputation is going good, the employees or the workers in the dental clinic will be continuously boosted and they'll be having a high morale and vice versa. Accountability. Accountability is responsibility. The way after every lecture, your CR will make a note of who is present and who is absent. And he makes it a point that so many lectures happen in a day, but every time they'll put that message for every group, for every lecture. What is that? Accountability, responsibility. If one assistant of the clinic and other dental assistant, both of them say, no, I'm not going to come this day because it's Raksha Bandhan, and you have 4-5 important patients lined up, then probably the employees in the institute or the clinic are not having this basic ethic of accountability, that 5-6 patients won't be getting a good treatment that particular day. So everybody should feel accountable. And then ethics of production. This is basically altogether a different set of ethics. I've just added one particular slide because we are one of those branches which make use of a lot of products, you know, dental materials, this, that, GIC, silicone impression materials, implants, ortho wires, lot of things. So also while we are dealing with the products that we are maybe producing as a manufacturer of a dental product, or maybe we are the user. That means we are a dentist who is using that particular product for our dental clinic. We should make it a point that we are never ever using any defective product over our patients. If it is expired, it's better to throw it. It is completely against the ethics that one must follow as a manufacturer as well as a user of the product. So whatever we saw until now was business ethics, which is basically related to the monetary aspect, decisions, and living up to your promises. Then we also are slightly related with all that part of the dentistry where research takes place. We have a different set of ethics for that. So today we'll be only discussing the history related to it. In detail, I'll just mention you about the guidelines. Probably you might just download the document and read it. So we all know whenever we are interns and when we are seeking our, you know, convocation ceremony, the candidacy and everything. So we all have, you as juniors, whenever you will be in internship, you will be doing that. And whenever we and my seniors, when we passed out, we took this oath, which is called as Hippocratic Oath. So this was developed in 4th century BC. And all doctors and practitioners have to take this oath. So what was the importance of the oath? The oath basically tells us to be equal towards everybody and always try to give as much as right treatment possible to your patients. And then there is something which is Nuremberg Code. Why suddenly we have rules and regulations for ethics? Why do we have a code of conduct for research, special rules and regulations? It all started because of this Nuremberg Code. It was long back in Germany during the Second World War. There was this human experimentation going on, inhuman experimentation, we can say, wherein a lot of people were actually fed or injected with medications and drugs without their knowledge, without their permission. There were people who were not given food for months and months, and their before and after was getting noticed. Basically, they were conducting human trials, human experimentation. But they were not taking into consideration the basic principle of our existence, that is humanity. And hence, these experiments are actually called as inhuman Nazi experiments. So these took for a period of around 1945 to 49. So you can say almost around 4 to 5 years. So these are a few of the pictures, as I said. Radioactive atoms were put inside their bodies. They were injected dopamines and various anesthetics and sedatives. So then these were not informed. I told you that there was this period for months they were not given food. This is that particular picture. And then thereafter was taken. That what will happen if they are not given food for months? And they were basically victimized. They were being used. So after that, after all those Nazi experiments, we came up with basically 10 guidelines or 10 lines or 10 set of rules, and those rules are called as Nuremberg Code. And Nuremberg Code was first ever set of rules and regulations that someone ever wrote thinking about research in mind. And then we have something which is called as Declaration of Helsinki. So we saw Hippocratic's Oath, and then we saw Nuremberg Code. And then after Nuremberg Code, there was a more detailed document, and this was Declaration of Helsinki. Nuremberg Code was made only for one country, which was Germany, and only in one country it was observed. Okay, it was yet not internationalized. So out of so many countries in the world, only one country was following it, and that was Germany, because it was the very same country where all these problems actually started. And then we have Declaration of Helsinki. It was various series of documents. जैसे जैसे ग्रोथ होती गई, चेंजेस हमने जैसे जैसे ऑब्जर्व किया, वैसे वैसे इट दिस पर्टिकुलर डॉक्यूमेंट अंडरवेंट 6 रिविजन्स एंड 2 क्लारिफिकेशंस. सो व्हाट इज बेसिकली डिक्लेरेशन ऑफ हेलसिंकी? इट इज अगेन नथिंग बट सेट ऑफ एथिकल रूल्स व्हिच इज डेवलप्ड बाय वर्ल्ड मेडिकल एसोसिएशन फॉर मेडिकल कम्युनिटी ह्यूमन एक्सपेरिमेंटेशन. यानी वर्ल्ड मेडिकल एसोसिएशन ने खुद के एक रूल्स बनाए हुए हैं कि अगर मेडिकल फ्रेटर्निटी के लोगों को कोई भी ह्यूमन एक्सपेरिमेंटेशन करना है, कोई टेक्निक बनानी है, कोई वैक्सीन बनाना है, कोई ड्रग बनाना है, कुछ भी इंसानों पर ट्राई करना है, उनको गिनीपिग जैसे यूज करना है, तो ये सेट ऑफ रूल्स फॉलो करना जरूरी है. और ये डिक्लेरेशन ऑफ हेलसिंकी भी बेसिकली इंस्पायर हुआ है 1947 के न्यूरनबर्ग कोड से ही. सो इट इज रिगार्डेड एज द कॉर्नरस्टोन डॉक्यूमेंट ऑफ ह्यूमन रिसर्च एथिक्स. सो बाकी जितने भी डॉक्यूमेंट्स बने, डिक्लेरेशन ऑफ हेलसिंकी इटसेल्फ इज इंस्पायर्ड फ्रॉम न्यूरनबर्ग कोड, which was basically made by Germany, and all other documents are basically more over here and there inspired for from Declaration of Helsinki. So basic principles are, if we go towards the second last and last line of this slide, assessment of risks versus benefits. Ki insano mein koi cheez try karne ke pehle, एक्सपेरिमेंट करने के लिए पहले, कोई केमिकल, कोई ड्रग, कोई वैक्सीन डालने के पहले, वन मस्ट वे मेजर कि इस चीज को करने के नुकसान कितने हैं और फायदे कितने हैं. अगर ये वैक्सीन देने से 90 लोगों को भी फायदा हो रहा है, 10 को नहीं हो रहा है, तो बेनिफिट कितना है? 90%. रिस्क कितना है? 10 लोगों को ही रिस्क है कि शायद उनको वैक्सीन लेने के बाद भी कुछ फायदा ना हो. सो दिस इज कॉल्ड एज असेसमेंट ऑफ रिस्क वर्सेस बेनिफिट्स. तो कोई भी चीज बॉडी में, ह्यूमन बॉडी में डालने से पहले ये माइंडसेट रखना इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. एंड देन वी हैव सेफगार्ड सब्जेक्ट्स इंटीग्रिटी. यानी जिस भी इंसान पर एक्सपेरिमेंट हो रहा है, उसकी प्राइवेसी को रिस्पेक्ट करना, कॉन्फिडेंशियलिटी मेंटेन करना, दिस इज द बेसिक ऑफ दिस डॉक्यूमेंट बेसिकली. एंड देन लेटर ऑन अगेन वर्ल्ड मेडिकल एसोसिएशन अडॉप्टेड डिक्लेरेशन ऑफ जेनेवा. Again, a series of rules that one must follow if they are working in the field of medicine as physicians. This is that entire declaration. Similarly, we have International Code of Medical Ethics, which was again given by World Medical Association in recently itself in 2006. So until now, what we have seen is we saw business ethics. That is that aspect of dentistry where money is involved. So how we are supposed to keep up our promises, be loyalty and commit to our excellence. And then we saw that long back, whenever experiments were conducted in amongst humans, there were no rules of regulations. Anybody was used as a guinea pig. So we came across Hippocratic Oath, we came across Nuremberg Code, and then we came across Declaration of Helsinki, and then we came across International Code of Medical Ethics and Declaration of Geneva by WMA. So to summarize, and now we can talk about the last part of this entire professional ethics. In the first slide, I had divided the entire topic into 3 main dimensions. So this is one of the other, or rather the most important dimension as a practitioner. That certain set of rules or a code of conduct that we should all follow when we are practicing. It is to do no harm, to do good, respect the person, justice, veracity or truthfulness, and confidentiality. They all actually sound the same, I know, but they mean different. Okay. So the first one is to do no harm. There are a lot of times when if we are probably not using the right instrument or something, we end up probing the tip of the probe too hard, or sometimes we end up spilling the drops of hypochlorite around, and there is necrosis of the tissue there. Anything that, basically any injury that is caused by a doctor or a dentist will be regarded as iatrogenic diseases. So if you're not in a position to treat the patient nicely or to do anything good, if you don't know how to do that particular set of treatment or particular skill of treatment, refer it to a senior. Refer it to a person who is more skilled in it. So just to earn some money or for that, for monetary reasons, one must not do any harm. You as students, when you go to find patients, because you have to complete your quota, so sometimes you end up lying ki nahi nahi 5 minute hi lagega, and then you come and you keep writing case history for 45 minutes 1 hour. That's harm. You don't know, probably he has another appointment, or maybe he has took a half day's leave or he has to go back, whatever. So this is like a mental injury to the patient, not giving respect to the person. So one must not do any harm to the patient if not good. So the first thing is, if you can't, don't do any harm. And then the second thing is, try to do good, but in every situation, beneficence. Beneficence is basically means to provide benefits. Whatever you do for the patient, make sure that whatever you do that helps the patient, it is of some kind of benefit to the patient. And then respect the person. If a patient, respect the person can be divided into two parts. How can we respect the person? By giving him his freedom. First is autonomy, which basically means give him his freedom, and informed consent. Don't try to do any procedure or anything without giving him proper information. So we will see what is autonomy. Autonomy basically means freedom from external control, or should not pressurize him ki nahi treatment aapko karwana hi padega, because you know ki you learn so and so amount. So you should not try to be that controller of decision. There should be no external control or influence. There should be freedom. Tell everything. Allow him to choose whatever is right for himself. Tell him that this is also available, this is also available, restoration is also available, GIC is also available, and composite is also available. Let him choose whatever he wants. Autonomy. If he says, no, I don't want to go to that particular place because so-and-so thing is good there. Okay, respect him. Autonomy. Allow him to take that decision. So, informed consent. What is basically a good informed consent? These are the 5 things that must be there in a good informed consent. Benefits. Whatever treatment you are doing, for example, it's extraction. So, daant nikalne ke fayde kya kya honge? और ये आप कोई रिसर्च कर रहे हो तो उस रिसर्च के फायदे क्या क्या होंगे, वो होंगे बेनिफिट्स। ये ट्रीटमेंट ना लेके आप ये ट्रीटमेंट भी ले सकते हो, उसको अल्टरनेटिव्स देना, यहाँ ना करवा के वहां पे भी करवा सकते हो, उसको फ्रीडम देना कि वो रिसर्च से क्विट भी कर सकता है, क्लिनिक है तो वो ट्रीटमेंट से बीच में क्विट कर सकता है। नेचर ऑफ ट्रीटमेंट उसको सच सच बताना कि कितना डिफिकल्ट, कितना अच्छा, कितना बुरा, व्हाट इज द प्रोग्नोसिस, व्हाट इज द सक्सेस रेट, what are the risks, what are the chances that the treatment might not work, and opportunity for questions. If the patient has questions ki acha theek hai ceramic mein kya kya type hai, allow him. Acha theek hai doctor implant nahi karwana hai to aur kya kya options hai, whatever. Opportunity for questions. So these 5 things, if they are fulfilled nicely, that comprises a good informed consent. It's a 2-step process. It could be of 2 type. What is informed consent is basically informing the patient ki hum aisa aisa kar rahe hain, aapko koi atraz to nahi hai. Wo hindi movies mein dekhte the na ki patient ke kareebi rishtedar kaun hai, and then they'll come and then they'll sign. So when they used to sign, then they would ask ki who are you of the relative. So when they write their name or anything, that is called as written consent, informed and written consent. यानी आपने उनको verbally भी बताया as well as document भी किया, written में भी लिखा. Or you can just inform the patient whatever procedure you are doing, always in the presence of a third party. That means unbiased third party. You should be present, your patient should be present, and one another person should be present, जिसके सामने treatment का सब कुछ decide हुआ था कि treatment कैसा होगा, कितने cost का होगा, उसके फायदे नुकसान सब कुछ. So that's a informed, verbal informed consent. So that was a previous slide. Then we have justice. Try to be nice to all your patients, whether they are rich, poor, nicely dressed or not nicely dressed, speaking good English, Hindi, or maybe some Irani language, whatever it is. Try to be just towards all your patients. Try to do your best. It is always about finding the right and wrong. Justice is all about never try to do anything wrong to your patient. That's it. Truthfulness. So they say ki doctor se kabhi kuch chupana nahi chahiye and lawyer se bhi kuch kabhi chupana nahi chahiye, because it is your doctor when only when you will trust your doctor and you will when you will tell it is paining or not affecting or not affecting, then only he can modify or continue with the treatment in a good or bad way. So be truthful towards your patient, as well as patients are supposed to be truthful towards their doctors. And then confidentiality. Whenever I have spoken about this, off late, though, I give example of Sushant Singh Rajput's case, wherein his psychiatrist was all over out in public and saying that he was having so-and-so bipolar syndrome, dual personality disorder, was taking these medications from so many years. So this is when you don't respect the privacy of your patient. You're not maintaining the confidentiality. Whatever is discussed between you and your patient is supposed to be kept very confidential. So if you breach that, then if you basically break that promise, it is called as breach of confidentiality. So it is our duty to mean whatever information patient gives us, we should try to keep it confidential unless and until the court of law sends you a document that so and so person ke upar ye ye case hai, wo aapke under mein treatment le rahe hain, and give their relevant information, then only you should share their information. And then, as I said, amongst all this, we have duties towards our patients, duties towards one another, and duties towards other dentists, towards public also. So how should be a doctor-patient relationship? It should be friendly, very gradual, courteous, sympathetic, and helpful. Because a person who is coming to a dental clinic is definitely in pain. So it should be friendly and helpful, sympathetic, and very professional. And then, what are the duties of one dentist towards one another? This is very important. Every dentist should cherish a proper pride in his or her colleagues and should not disparage them with words or act. Every dentist, yeah, they could be your competitors, but then you're supposed to treat them with pride and respect. And never use bad words or belittling words in front of patient for any other doctor. If there is any issue, once the patient leaves, you can call the doctor and say, ki, I read so-and-so thing, I thought I should call you and clarify, whatever it is. But you should always take pride amongst your colleagues. Also, you should try to help your colleagues. If anybody has done some, if one patient comes to you, ki maine wahan se ye 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 filling karwaya tha, lekin abhi dukh raha hai, and then you take an X-ray and you realize ki the RCT was not done properly. So you should not have this attitude ki arre pehle to tum wahan gaye the treatment karwane, now I'm not going to help you. No, it is not like that. It's okay. Maybe the previous person, because of so and so reasons, did a faulty restoration or a faulty root canal. But you should still try to help the patient. And if maybe you're called as a consultant, you should still try to help the patient as well as the owner of the clinic in that case. So we all have our dentist, our duties towards our patients as well as towards each other. And then on a whole, whatever we do, if we are not doing anything good to the society, if we are not adding any value to the society, then everything is waste. So we have our duties towards the people. So people should take efforts, come ahead, act leader to solve problems oral health problems, it could be a syndrome, it could be as a simple issue as dental caries, or maybe just giving oral health education. So we all have our duties towards the public. That is, we should contribute towards the society. This is our basic ethic. Two, three more slides I have added, keeping in mind the present situation. Charging of fees and fee splitting. So you can see the last line. It says it is unethical to enter into a contract of no cure, no payment. Sometimes patient says, kya, wo filling kya, fir bhi dukh raha hai, to nahi hum payment nahi denge. No, that is never the kind of contract we go for. When we start the patient, then only we should very clearly in front of a third person mention ki aapka ye treatment ho raha hai, aapko ye itna uska fee hoga, and specially if that patient is having any kind of insurance policy. And fee splitting, agar ek main dental clinic mein uske yahan koi subordinate or consultant aa raha hai, so it should be discussed right in front of the patient ki so and so would be the charge, so and so we will give to so and so consultant. And then prescription of drugs, be ethical. Just because patient is very uncooperative and something, and we end up giving 5-6 medicines to the patient, is just not an ethical practice. We should take into account proper case history and everything, and try to give the right amount of drugs that the patient needs without any bias towards any particular brand while prescribing drugs. Over-investigating the patient. This is actually quite tricky a point because our ethics says that we should not over-investigate. Just because ek CT scan ya MRI se 6-7,000 extra aa raha hai, toh chalo kar lete hain. No, avoid over-investigation. If it is not needed, one must not do it. But if we see towards the second point of this slide, it appears that no doctor is now willing to make a diagnosis, and no patient is willing to accept one without recourse to the formidable diagnostic armory of the medical industrial complex. So, kitna hi patient ko bol do, nahi, aap do din ye dawai khao, uske baad mein aap theek ho jaoge. Patient will not trust. And, nahi, ye doctor ye test karna hai kya, like that. And so, it has now become like that. Agar doctor ne zyada test de diya, toh what test deta hai? Nahi diya, toh kuch test hi nahi karwa, bas aise do dawa likhe de di. So in both the cases, it is a problem for a practitioner to decide actually what to do. But that is what ethics is all about, to find out what is right, what is wrong, to find out that right balance wherein you're ethical as well as legal. So what are unethical practices? We all know that there are various unregistered people which are employed by the dentist. One must avoid to practice in such situations. Signing medical certificates just for money, untrue certificates, misleading certificates, probably because that person is getting some leave or insurance, something like that. So these practices should be avoided. Direct or indirect advertising. Advertisement karna bhi unethical hai, because they say healthcare is not a business. Even though we started with the business aspect of it, but then we ended up with Nuremberg Code and so many other things, wherein soft skills and being sensitive towards humans was so important. So direct or indirect advertising is not considered ethical, especially for the field of medicine or dentistry. Though it is widely prevalent, right now it is just a practice. Some few here and there laws, but then no proper law as such to stop all this. Use of bogus diplomas. Just writing 2-3 letters next to the degree about diplomas that don't exist. Probably those were the diplomas which were not granted by eligible body. Or undercharging for solicit patients. Kabhi-kabhi undercharging, that means charging less to patients, should be done when the patient can't afford it. If patient can afford it, then you're not charging them well. Then probably you're taking the privilege of somebody else to seek that sort of oral health care. So one must avoid these unethical practices. So to conclude, I will say it's in the end always about being ethically correct. Whether it's research, legally correct, ethically correct, as well as legally correct, be it research, be it while we are transacting with our patients as a part of business ethics, or we are just practicing in our dental clinic or at an institution under or over somebody. So in the end, there is a very thin line between what's right, what's wrong, to not to an individual, but to a society on a whole. If we try to understand this basic thin line towards everything that's ethical and non-ethical, and if we try to start trying to encourage all those things that are ethical and legal, I think our branch will prosper a lot. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Pallavi. It was a very nice presentation. You covered the topic thoroughly into three categories. Otherwise, there is always a confusion that professional ethics should include what all things. So it was nicely divided into three categories. I just want to like add one more aspect of it. Maybe the professional ethics include your dress code policy. As a teacher, as a dentist in the practice, or as a researcher, your dress code, a uniform code, that if it is followed, it looks more professional. That's the only thing. The rest all is perfect.
Wow, thank you so much.
If there is any question anybody wants to ask or discuss something, if anybody wants to ask something, discuss over it.
I could see Shreya Bhavsar was raising her hand. Let me ask her if she is really.
What was my mistake?
Shreya, I could see you raising hand. If you wish to ask a question, please ask.
Anybody else is having any question, I'll be very glad to answer. Or anybody just wants to revisit any of these slides.
Before anybody wants to ask a question, I just would like to tell everyone.
There are no more questions.
Why have we kept this session? Why have we kept this seminar or workshop for everyone? It's because in our academic career, we always study, we always work on the topics which are given to us by Dental Council of India and for which we conduct exams. So we learn only those topics or those subjects. But professional ethics is one aspect which helps us in growing on the professional front and which is quite ignored. So if all these students, all these staff members are well aware of all these professional ethics, and also if they are reminded every now and then we are able to produce a generation which is working in a professional and ethical manner. So that was that is the basic intention of conducting such sessions. That's all from my
side. Very true, sir. There are no questions, but there are many comments coming up. It was a very nice presentation. So, congratulations, Dr. Pallavi.
Yes, Pallavi, really a nice presentation.
Oh, thank you so much, ma'am. It will.
So yes, we'll conclude
the 3 PM because right after lunch.
yes, doctor. Yes, Dr. Pallavi Patil. It's a very good session. We all really enjoyed, and we are all.
It really means a lot to me, sir.
Yeah, very good message. It has given a very good message to everyone. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
I could see
yes, ma'am.
Many of the participants probably from first year who had a lecture till 3:30.
Dr. Bhushan, can I speak?
Yes, ma'am.
A few years back, like the last point to what Dr. Amit Agarwal added. Like a few years back, students were used to come and buy a dress code. Buy a dress code is needed in college. But they don't realize that the patients who come to college, they see you, though you are learning, see you as doctors. So, and this has this feedback was given to me in my department by a patient only, that an intern was working and they were very casual in talking or in their dress code. And then that patient came to me later and said that these are not doctors, these are learning. I said, no, they are doctors. No, the way they are, and then they judge you and respect you as a doctor. So the most important message to the students will be, it is not that what we want that you should wear this or you should, it is, we are not encroaching on that aspects of your freedom. But since you are in a, even for staff, it will be the same. We don't want to encroach on anybody's personal aspects. But then when it is a professional college, yes, there are some ethics to be followed. And we have to go along with it because the entire, for staff to the even students are looking up to us. The students look up to us. The patients look up to us. Exactly. Yes. And same way for the, when the students are treating, the patients are looking up to you as doctors. So it is very important that you behave, be dressed and speak like a professional doctor. That's all.
I would just like to reinforce whatever ma'am said. As she said, there was this point during the presentation, which was about leadership. So if we are, we as staff or we as seniors are following the dress code, we are leading it. Then automatically students will also follow it. I think that was a very valid point raised by ma'am. Thank you so much, Dr. Pradeep and Dr. Meenal ma'am, for your valuable inputs. Yes, Pustaka sir, you were saying something. Please go ahead.
Yeah, I just could see first year students probably joining. Suddenly, a lot, many students joined. So I think now we cannot repeat the lecture for them, but the YouTube link will surely be provided for all of them. Or if they wish.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Because around 50 to 60 students suddenly joined, I mean, maybe 5-10 minutes back.
We will reschedule it someday, sir.
They will be able to see that, through YouTube link, which will be provided by tomorrow.
Yes. About the conversation, what Minal madam said, na, that how we converse, that also patient observes.
So yes,
psychologically,
yes.
When two people are talking, the third person is more involved in that.
Yes.
So when you and me are talking, we talk in our terms as normally we meet or something like that. But the third person is having his impression.
Yes,
so when we talk to the patient, will be very formal, IA, baithi and whatever and all not. But as soon as our